Welcome to another special edition episode of Last Week in Quantum. This is the show where we review the top news in the world of quantum and its impacts on the world of cybersecurity, AI, and more. I'm your host, Rebecca Krauthamer, and today we have an expert in the field of quantum and emerging tech, Skip Sanzeri. Skip and I go way back. Skip is the co-founder and COO at QuSecure, and he's also the author of the Quantum Design Sprint on quantum computing application development. We are here today, as this is Last Week in Quantum, we're here to talk about his new article in Forbes on AI agents and how this relates to quantum computing. Skip, welcome.
Yeah, thank you, Becca.
Awesome. This is a topic that is hugely near and dear to my heart. I got into the quantum computing space via AI. So my background in terms of study was in AI and implementation. And I think we can't emphasize more the potential of quantum technologies and their impact that they're going to have on AI. So that's how I was initially brought into the field. Quantum promises to unlock so many doors in computation, and it's an exciting way to usher in that new era. But you're talking about something slightly different, which is also something I love talking about: the implications of this new era that we're entering into of classical AI, even. And what are the implications when it comes to cybersecurity? And of course, when we're talking about quantum, the quantum threat to encryption is always an important part of this discussion. So you talk about AI agents. So first of all, can you define what an AI agent is?
Sure. Becca, thank you. I mean, AI agents are everywhere, and they're in different forms, and they're in different levels of strength. I mean, you know, you've got AI agents in Amazon. When you go on, it's going to recommend things. It's always thinking about what you're doing. You've got AI agents that you use in something like OpenAI's ChatGPT. If you've tried some of the newer ones, you can actually talk to that agent. That agent sounds remarkably human, right? And those agents are out there in a variety of forms, whether you're shopping or searching or researching, setting travel plans. Every single technology company that I've seen out there is now integrating AI in, and those agents are there to be a little more personal, a little more helpful, because the idea is you're getting service and utility out of these agents that are guiding you and making your life a lot easier, whatever you're trying to do. Now, that also translates to buying products and services, things, as we know. But nonetheless, AI agents are everywhere. They're on your phone. Every time you use Siri, or Alexa, or any of them, they're everywhere. So there's a proliferation of ways that AI is now infiltrating. And now our job is to figure out how to maneuver these and maneuver them securely.
Yeah. I could not agree more. I mean, I use ChatGPT on the daily now. There are these things that can make our lives so much better. And, you know, again, going back to, I got into this space because there's this whole new frontier of technology that we're facing with quantum. And as technology becomes more and more ingrained, intertwined with what we do day to day, there's more and more that we have to do. And it's more and more important to be able to shape the foundations of how these emerging technologies serve us for good. And so the cybersecurity side, the data security side, is such an important piece of this that I think we still don't really day to day think enough about. Shaping the foundation so that we all can safely interact with these sharing very personal information, hugely critical. So what is, you know, what kinds of data are you seeing most at risk when it comes to sharing information with these agents?
Wow. Most is a tough question, Becca, because it's everything. You know, if you think about all of your interactions, so we used to call it a digital twin or a digital shadow. So, you know, as you go through life, you know, once you had a phone and a smartphone and you've got these other in-home items and enterprises using AI, All of these devices, all of these items now are able to track data and keep data. And all that data is being stored, every bit of it. Because how does AI get smarter? It gets smarter with data. It learns more about you. It learns more about the world. It learns more about what it needs to know. And that database gets larger and larger and larger. While it's doing that, it brings in a couple of points of failure. One is you have all that data stored, whether it's enterprise data, federal government data, personal data. all in one area. And then you also have the communications as that data is traveling around. And there's a lot of issue there as well, because traveling data is going over the airwaves in a lot of cases, and sometimes over fiber. But both of those can be listened to, and all of that data can be stored. And so as we depend more on AI agents and to help us make our lives a lot easier, and we know this is coming, and everybody that's watching this, I know, is using AI more and more. While that convenience is there, we trade convenience for privacy all the time. And we do it. It's a little bit insidious, because when something comes out, think of when Waze came out. How excited were we with Waze? Like, oh my goodness, you know, the thing's giving me directions and it's rerouting me and I got optimization to that next point. Guess what? Somebody that got in that could see all the places you've been, where you're going. And so just the use of these, but we're not going to stop, Becca. We're not going to stop using more and more of this. The idea now is, how can we do it in the most secure fashion to make sure that there's no fundamental problems with enterprise data, government secrets, personal information being leaked, systems being taken over, and issues that we may end up with in the future, because there's always nefarious folks out there that will, you know, that will go to this larger digital twin, digital shadow, data duplicated everywhere, and they'll use that for their own purposes.
So in just in summary, is how this relates to the quantum space. I see it in two ways. And you're talking about one. The first way is, all of this data can be that travels over networks. It can be harvested now for later decryption via quantum computer. So that's something that we have to think about, is when we share that explicit data, those data points, that data, if not properly encrypted with quantum safe encryption, can ultimately be decrypted and viewed by maybe actors that you don't want to have access to that data. I think the second thing that I always think about too, and I encourage people to think about, is the future of data analysis is beyond anything that we understand or can do today. For example, here's a relevant example. It's possible that 23andMe will be acquired by another organization at this time, right? A lot of people have shared really their genetic data with 23andMe. And now it's a big question as to, okay, what is, if there's a new company that has access to that data, what are they going to do with that data? And that's up to them. So I think that the takeaway that I like to remind people is, when you share this data, it's not just the data that you're sharing, but it's the potential for that data to be interpreted in ways that you didn't plan for. And that's something that quantum computing does very much potentially unlock, is looking at data like genetic data, like some of the health data you're talking about, behavioral data, and being able to analyze that in ways that we can't currently with today's analytical tools. And so that, you know, that one's a little bit further off, but I think it's an important one to understand, is that if we don't properly protect this data today, we still don't know what kind of analysis may be run on that data for good and for bad, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, Becca, there are, you know, many, many ways that data can be used and abused, and we lose control of it. We lose control of it. I think the goal here is, in at least in my estimation, number one is people are going to continue to use AI and agents more and more and more and more. It's never going to stop. The second thing is that data that's used, whether it's traveling across or stored and or used by other companies, like you said, that data is going to be made available to a lot of people. And they, as long as we're aware of that going in and we know the risks, then we have at least a voice in being able to be part of the solution, which is securing that data in transit, securing that data at rest with cryptography that makes it really hard to break, making sure that companies and federal governments are responsible in the same fashion. There's a lot that can be done, because again, this is going to happen. We all know it, we're all doing it, but let's go in heads up. Let's go in with a plan. Let's go in pushing agendas to say, hey, how about we think of security first in a product rather than the product itself? Go in secure first, go in privacy first, and then build your products. And then, you know, it gives us the best chance.
100%. Well, I think that's all the time we have, but I think to put emphasis on your last point, people, we have the right to trust that our data is being properly encrypted for that day when there's a quantum computer with 4,000 error corrected qubits to break current encryption. And when, again, when you have a 4,000 qubit quantum computer, decryption is not the only thing that you can do with it. But I think it's just so important. And I think what you're emphasizing is we as consumers of this technology need to be very aware and also demand that that our data is being treated in a security first way. And quantum safe encryption is a huge part of that. So thank you for raising the awareness around this. And thank you for being part of the show.
Thank you, Becca.
Thank you. And if you're interested in learning more, you can catch us soon on our webinar with Horizon X Consulting. Thank you, everyone, for joining.